so.
You set the scene.
Okay. I mean, I told you a little bit about what we wanted to cover, and.
But you're supposed to say we're here on whatever, as you did with Ed Moses.
Okay. We'll start off, I'm sorry. December 5th, we're sitting here at the home of Karl Benjamin, and we're Andrew Perchuk, Tom Lerner, Catherine Taft, and Rani Singh are interviewing Karl Benjamin on the occasion of the impending Pacific Standard Time project. And I gave you a little overview of what we wanted to talk about, but maybe we can start with, you know, how you were exposed to art and if you took art classes at the university at Northwestern and the move to Redlands. So maybe you can tell us a little bit about
how you got started and
how you were exposed to art and how it even became a possibility of.
Did you grow up going to the Art Institute when you were in Chicago?
No, I didn't. I knew there were lions out in front, but that was all I knew about that building. I had no experience in art in college and growing up. There's a lot of music in my house and reading, but there's nothing, none of the visual arts. And when I was in the Navy for 3 years after high school, and then I had no idea what I wanted to be. Except I wanted to be a writer. So when I started at Northwestern, I monkeyed around with that as a major. And then I came out to California after the war.
What caused you to come out to California?
Although I just got out of the Navy, and so did my father. He was a doctor, he was a commander. We both got out at the same time. And we lived in Evanston, Illinois, and we both came out the service at the same time. And so he wanted to move out to California, and I guess I wasn't ready to leave home yet. So I came along with my sister and mother and father. And he's a pathologist, and we moved to Redlands. And I finished up school at the University of Redlands. And there I had no art. I had English, philosophy, and history, and tried to write short stories. So Beverly and I, my wife, got married the year I was a senior and she was a junior. And I was at that point wanting to be a writer. And I was getting rejection things from all the best magazines.
And you wanted to be a a Hemingway? Or
no, it's something like that, somewhere between that and Faulkner.
Mm-hmm.
So anyhow, I got married. I graduated, Beverly had a year to go, and I had to get a job. And the only job I could get right there in Redlands was emergency credential for teaching sixth grade. And I just took it out of desperation. They were looking for teachers right after the war. They were young men.
Sure.
And I don't know, this has been written up a bunch of times, and I hate to be repetitive, but it's such a big time in my life. I had sort of an epiphany that year. For a year, there was just supposed to be a fill-in until Beverly graduated, and we went off to Boulder, Colorado, to get an MFA in writing, both of us.
Mm-hmm.
So they told me that I was doing fine at school, but that I wasn't doing any art. And I said, I don't know anything about art. Now I was 23 now, about 23. And I said, I don't know anything about art. I don't know the name of Picasso and Vermeer, but that was about it. So you have to do it. So I just passed out art crayons and paper and said, make some art. I really was that simple-minded about the whole thing, thinking just to fill in 45 minutes once a week,
mm-hmm.
so I could say I did it. And meanwhile, I was getting some really good poetry out of these kids, believe it or not. They were a very poor district, and they had no background. But they were all somehow. I played a lot of music in class, and somehow these poems came out, and it intrigued me that this was happening here. And then all of a sudden, after I was forced to give them art materials, they began doing things that looked very interesting. I couldn't figure out why they were interesting. Mm-hmm. So I began reading about art. And by the end of that year, I bought some paint and started messing around in the garage. And that's really how I got started in art. Then what would happen the second year? The second year, I remember, instead of going to Boulder for a master's in writing, we got pregnant. So I had another year out at the same place. But by this time, I was really turned on to it. And it was not, looking back, it was interesting that the powers that be at that school were not at all impressed with what I was having these kids do, because their parents would come and say, he's making them do these things and they're not art. And
when did you decide that you was reading that originally they would draw pictures of houses or trees or something, and then you told them you wanted them to do color and
well, they didn't know what to do, so they did a sun and a mountains and a tree, and I just, or a truck. And so I just said, don't do anything like that. I knew that was, it was just boring. So I said, just make pretty colors. I had no idea what I said, doing non-objective art. I mean, and then they would work on something, and they had to finish the paper. They had to finish the, fill up the paper. And if they would come up and say, I'm stuck, I don't know what to do next, I said, well, just use the color that looks best with what's there already. And they'd say, okay, and they go back and do it. Little did I know what that okay took until I got out here and was trying to figure out what the next color was going to be. So anyhow, that's how, by the end of that year, I had already started to mess around myself and read. And then we started to go to Los Angeles, and there were three galleries that were any good at that point. Frank Pearls is the only one I remember. And hotel galleries at the Biltmore and the...
What were you seeing at Pearls? Were you seeing some of the... Pearls
was showing Paul Klee and School of Paris. Post-impressionists.
Is it true, a lot of people have written that there were two artists that were particularly important to you?
Two artists?
Two artists, Juan Gris and Lionel Feininger. Is that true?
They were just two of many.
Okay.
And since I had no background, I would see stuff in books, and I would like, or Miro, or whatever, and I would try to do something like that. That's like what I told the kids in school. Do something that looks... So that's how I've tried very much finding... For some of them were influential in a sense that I painted things that looked a lot like that, like Feininger, and some Miro, and Cubism. And then the New York School that just had come out at that point. So,
were you familiar with the Galka Shire collection?
Yeah, at the Pasadena Museum. That was the museum then, much more active than the L.A. County. We used to go there, and of course it was easy to get to, and they had a big show every year, San Gabriel Valley annual show, which was the first show I was ever in. I remember Ed Keenholz, a couple of the early years, hauling in a big three-dimensional painting, sort of, before he was doing.
But at that point, you had been working on your own paintings and developing your own style.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just independent of really interacting with other artists. It was more starting...
Well, it was like certain things came more and more. And the first show I had, which was Pasadena Museum, in 54, I think. There was two kinds of paintings in there. There were Feininger-esque sort of cubism. And and I think there's some totally abstract stuff already. I don't know if it's a hard edge in that, but they were not landscapes or houses or still lives like the Feiningers. Excuse me.
You need the water. Just, you know, you can stop anytime you want. Mm-hmm. Not a problem. Not a performance.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's just tape.
Okay.
It's not even tape. It's all digital.
Yeah.
No tape. But so, just to back up a little bit, you know, that was in 1954 when you had a solo show, but you had moved to Claremont. And maybe you can tell us about the year, you know, what year you came here and what other artists were. I mean, it was almost an artist community.
Yeah, there was.
And starting graduates.
It was a real movement here, but instead of Picasso, we had Millard Sheets, who hated my work, who kicked me out of the student show. He said, he told me once, we're not all that much in love with Picasso here, he said. And he was a typical conservative painter, but had Badger Hills people here. They were Phil Dyke, those were names that were, Bert Stewart, they were all turn of the century. Nice guys, but they were very conservative. But I only came here because I went in Redlands, then I went back to teaching some more. And I was painting in the garage, and I had 2 years left on the GI Bill. So I thought I'd take off. So I took off that year and enrolled at a very friendly art teacher at University of Redlands, who let me kind of mess around because I was older than most of them. There was a terrible art scene there. It was not only a bad art scene, they too wouldn't let me put my stuff in the shows. Then I heard about Claremont. So we came down here in 50, was it about 51?
52.
And there was this burgeoning movement here, and as I say, Sheets was here. But there are a lot of guys my age who are already quite ahead of me. Doug McClellan, Paul Darrow, Bob Frame, Sue Hertel. They were really good at that time. The post-war surge of art schools were more mature guys were coming back in. So I was a real beginner back here, which was fine because I was learning a lot from my friends who also teached me in a sense. So that's how we got here. And it seemed to be a nice community. And we got to get to Los Angeles because this is Peoria out here. Nobody's going to come out here and look at your stuff. But by this time, I had two kids and I liked that part of it, and I liked having a house, and I couldn't see doing that in Los Angeles. And I really got something out of teaching. It was a good thing.
So as you're starting to develop as an artist, and one of the things that seems interesting to me is the different relation out here than, let's say, artists in New York to European art. You know, they had seen, especially New York artists of the 30s, a very bad experience with geometric abstraction. You know, the American Abstract Artists Group and those groups in the 30s.
Yeah.
You know, they felt, the artists of your generation, New York, felt that those guys were sort of the enemy, but that wasn't at all the case, right, for you about geometric abstraction. Or how did you feel?
I just wasn't, I really wasn't thinking in terms of those terms. I mean, I'd like a certain kind of painter, whether it was, I tried to paint like de Kooning, I tried to paint like Pollock. I never tried to do hard edge painting because I didn't think that was very arty. I mean, I didn't feel like art. Little did I know, I mean, where I, my footsteps led me, but. So I don't know, I have so many. You were just looking at that one book in there, the Scura.
Yeah.
The first color plate is, I was doing my best to be a New York abstract expressionist. You can see it in that painting, and that's what I was trying, but I could only get so far in the painting and then I couldn't finish them. And so I finally quit trying to do the wrist stuff.
What was the problem? Were you saying you only got so far?
Well, I mean, I couldn't realize the painting. I couldn't. And then I got off to a great start, and then about two-thirds of the way through, nothing started to happen. And then that kind of veered into finding your esque kind of cubism. And I don't.
But there's not such a distinction, at least when I look at your paintings. Some people think it's sort of the opposite of abstract expressionism, but it's really not, because like them, you're very interested in an all over surface, right? That doesn't have that push and pull of the European.
I don't think I verbalize this stuff that much. I mean, I wasn't thinking like in those terms. If you could put that in a different way, I'm not quite sure.
I'm just trying to say that, you know, when you look at a Mondrian, something here balances something there. And when you're de Kooning, it's sort of looking at the surface as one entire
drawing. Right.
And that seems to me something that you always do as well. You get a rhythm across the surface. But
yeah, Well, most of these paintings, I mean, I start off with soft charcoal on canvas, just automatic drawing. After I got into something, with something vaguely in mind. And then rubbing out some lines and adding others. And then when I got feeling some sense of there, I got a straight edge and started to even it up. I mean, like all of these started in that same way, just real random. But I never was turned on in my younger days by Mondrian, and I wasn't against them philosophically. I just visually, I found it very boring.
Okay.
That's the word. I wouldn't say they were boring now, but I'm still much more excited about de Kooning.
So maybe you can take us from, you said, you know, there's some paintings that are some a little surrealist, like Murrow, a little Feininger, some New York school. And then you start with first the symmetries or the totem group that is really very much your own style.
Gee, if I could only see that painting above the cupboard up there.
Yeah.
That's a real transitional painting. That's really a good painting to.
Should I bring it?
Yeah.
Bring it over here?
Yeah.
We have a really nice selection.
Well, that's
images too, and they're in order. So
yeah.
Do you want to talk about this one first?
No, not that one.
Not that one.
That's something else. I can, you know, I can do it with this.
Okay.
So you can see that from here. But I was doing a lot of painting with a palette knife, thick paint, until things like that came along.
Ooh. Andrew, if you want to just leave it there and we'll put it, we'll rehang it after.
If you could, you don't need to show the camera. It's more important to show, to, you know, to look at yourself and then just show us a little bit.
Okay.
As a visual image, you're holding stuff up. It's not. Hold
it up for me like that.
That's so great.
I see. But you can see this.
Yeah.
And so with these, some of these, I would get these hard edges with a thick paint. I would tape off the light colors, which are a lot of white, so there was physically a lot of paint there. And I would paint smoothly the field, and then paint on top of that, tape it off with my palette knife, put the paint on, so you can see the thickness of it as you look at that painting, or any of these. Gee, these are such a mix. I don't know if I'm going to jump around too much.
Okay. That's okay.
Carl, can you tell us that, last time you told us that the use of the palette knife was a real transitional moment in your work.
The use of it?
Yeah. Oh. Is that?
Well, I love the feel of paint. I really, and that's what I couldn't do it with a brush. I think that's why I did it with a palette knife.
And so when you started using a palette knife, you were able to use a lot more paint and a lot.
Well, it just felt better. I'm not doing real well with this. Part of it's I can't. I'm fighting my throat. I'm trying to make words right and thoughts right. And
you want to take a break?
We can take a break too at any point.
Well anyhow, this was the very that group of paintings was the next two. For instance, that year, a little later, this one. There again, I was trying my idea of symmetry. And I come out with three-dimensional form. You never know what you're gonna. I had no idea about anything except three-dimensional form.
But the symmetry gave you a structure.
Well, I guess so.
Primarily oils.
Always. We were talking before about media. I only used as soon as I got going, even though I couldn't afford it, Winsor Newton finest oil paintings, because I read a lot about Mayer and Dorner and all the books on art, not technical stuff, materials. And all at that time, what was in style was ignoring. That was academic. Paint with carb paint, paint on old signs. And everybody used to kid me when I was a graduate student over here. Why I was buying Winsor Newton paint, you know, when I was driving a third-hand car, and I just thought there's no point in spending a lot of time to get the right color. And then screw it up with paint. So I figured alizarin crimson is the one most. It was the most fugitiveness of any color. If it was more so than that, I wouldn't use it. And Winsor Newton was the best, I thought. And I used a little stand oil for medium, because a lot of them would use anything from sour milk to. So I was very careful, and that's why I think a lot of those paintings from the 50s. Really looked like I just painted them. They didn't get banged around.
Well, it's incredible to see your work, alongside many of the other people who were painting around the same time. Because as you saw in *Birth of the Cool*, a lot of the surfaces have really degraded, but yours look still stellar.
I remember Lorcer Feilson, who was the dean of painting, one of the three deans in LA at that time. He and probably Sheets, and probably the Hungarian.
Brieke LeBrun.
The Hungarian was Deirdre. LeBrun, yeah. What was this?
We were talking about the materials that Lorcer.
Oh, Lorcer would do the most, give you the most outlandish advice. He'd say, if you take some just raw canvas and you wet it down, you can put paint on it quicker. And that was still oil. They weren't much in the way of acrylics at that point. And but painting on raw canvas that you made wet, I mean, shitty stuff. But he was the dean of art, you know. But it was against, you know, Duchamp and those guys made fun of academic painting. But I just didn't want to spend all this time getting the right color and then having it fade. I'm paying for it. I made a mistake twice. There was a Shiva was kind of popular for a while, and they made a color called Panso Pink. That was like a warm alizarin. And you people used to figure that if you know what alizarin crimson is, that was sort of the mid step between the two kinds of colors. And I felt you had to have that to paint with. So I just didn't use anything that was more fugitive than that. And so that was one of the.
And those ones have not held up well?
Well, that the pink, I've got two of them here someplace. When I was taping, I gave two coats to each paint, each color. And I mixed double and wrapped it up in saran wrap. And then when it all was dry, I'd give it a second coat for the most part. And also by the time I got around to the second coat, it was 2 weeks later, at least. And I realized already that this pink was changing radically. And so I quick stopped using it, but I ruined about five or six, seven paintings.
And call that was a fading of the color you were noticing when you said it was.
Pardon me?
The pink was fading. You were noticing a change.
It was a beautiful warm pink. It was a warm pink. And then when I repainted it with exactly the same color, I could see this radical, cheesy looking pink underneath, and the new color was still okay.
Yeah. But that was specific to that one color.
Yeah. I didn't do a lot of mixing. No. Except, I mean.
Can we stop 1 second?
Sure.
Only two mistakes, and the one was the Shiva, and then you told us last time about a green, right?
A green, but that was the fault of Grumbacher. They had a permanent green light, which crinkled like a old master painting that looks like a mud flat. Well, that's what this did. It separated.
So once it was applied, it the surface.
Kind of, yeah. And then there was a third thing that I screwed up on, but that was, I caught on after a while. It took a while to happen. Everybody knows that ivory black is the blackest black, but it's physically not very strong. So I would mix ivory black with Mars black, which was not that black, but it was a very sturdy body. And I did a series of paintings called Black on Black. And really the only thing that was, it'll say BB number 14 or something is the title. And so you'll see where I put in, trying to get real black, I put in too much ivory black. And what happened there again, it looks like the mud flat. It's separated, you can see the canvas. And what you're seeing is white canvas underneath it, so it really, I've got a couple still around here.
It'd be great to look at those a bit later.
But instead of, but there are very, very few that I lost.
You say, Carl, you said that, if we can stick with the sort of technique for just a while, you said you mainly worked with Winsor Newton oil colors. You've already mentioned Grumbacher and Scheiber. So were these other paint types tried when they were just around, or were they sort of recommended, or did you?
Well, everybody was using them, and you see ads for them, and because you just barely knew about acrylics at that point.
And I mean, did you notice, was the Winsor Newton choice because everyone was suggesting it was the best, or because it was the most expensive, or did you actually like the actual?
Well, I made a chart of all the cadmiums, and three or four. Permanent pigments, Grumbacher, Scheiber, Winsor Newton, and I looked at them, and they just seemed to resonate, but they're very expensive.
Yeah.
They're incredibly expensive now.
And was it a sort of depth of color, or a gloss, or a opacity that you liked about them, or just the?
No, it's just they're very strong pigments.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, can we just talk through the whole process of making a painting? I'm actually not clear how it's changed through your life, but it seems it's been a pretty.
But we go a little slower and a little louder, mind.
It's your process of actually making the painting from start to finish. I was wondering if we could just talk through that process, and I mean. Your process may have changed throughout the sort of throughout your life, but it seems fundamentally it's been a very similar process. So have you always worked on canvas or any other?
For the most part, yeah.
And I mean, was that board pre-stretched? Was it primed, or was it
both?
Okay.
And then when I began teaching in college and especially with the graduate students, there was always somebody that wanted to make canvases and that could do it. So then I started to pay them to do it, but I would always try to do at first masonite, and then bought canvas already sized.
And do you know if the bought canvases, the size canvases, were they primed with a white?
Well, whatever they. Can't remember now. What I would prime them with when I did them was whatever. I can't remember now.
Did you use rabbit skin glue, or did you use?
No, I did way long time just to see what. Yeah, in the 50s. That was a really sincere then. Where you rabbit skin glue on linen.
You're probably using an acrylic primer or an alkyd primer, just a sort of fairly quick drying white.
When I was doing it later on, it was a quick drying white, so it was acrylic based. The acrylic based paint.
Yeah. And then, as you're doing your composition, sketching out in charcoal, and then the straight line. Are you erasing a lot of the sort of mess, or is that there still beneath all the paint as you apply your layers?
I'm sorry, I'm afraid I don't get the.
When you start by charcoal drawing,
yeah,
and then as you get the straight lines, do you erase the charcoal, or do you just leave it?
Oh, well, after I got, I dust it off and do it with pencil. Yeah.
Did you do things freehand at the beginning?
Yeah. Until I knew where I was going, and then I straightened it out like all of these. But although then I think maybe I'm jumping too much, but probably in the late 70s I started using systems. And I think in the late 70s, certainly the 80s, I think like a lot of artists, you're a good painter now, you're you've learned how to design and do all the things. And so it, you begin to feel almost like you're doing some tricks that you've learned how to do. So I started to use systems, which were not randomly done. Number systems.
Well, there's the checkerboard.
Checkerboards were sort of that way. Checkerboards the alphabet, one color and one block color, one block on the field, then one, then two letters, one on top of another.
That you would consider a system, maybe, or not?
These were all, happen to be right here. It was one or two. So it was some modification that you're basically, so you're not making forms in the same sense that we were talking about before. And then I had, and then the graduate students were all kidding me that I wasn't having any social content in my work. I tried to tell them that was in my politics, but they didn't accept that. So I did a Viet Cong series. I in my Viet Cong series, and yeah, it must be. Well, there was a V.
That's okay, you can describe, we don't need to, you can just describe it.
There was a V and a C on a square, like a V over a C. Now take that module and do it clockwise across the top, and then the next row opposite, counterclockwise, and the third row clockwise. And you work with that.
But Carl, this was always done on the actual.
You want to give me that? Who's got
the? I'm going to pull some of the ones that we want to talk about, and then.
Why don't I trade with Tom also so you can
okay,
go?
Damn.
Carl, this was all done on the actual painting. You would never make sketches or drawings to kind of decide on a composition and then move it to the painting?
Sometimes.
Okay.
It looks like I painted in a straight line, but I haven't, and I really take it apart. I mean, things like that one, for instance, are just, you're just putting a line that you go this way, and it's like you, like John Maron talked about painting a bird, it goes this way and dips that wing and go that way. And so that was really action painting in a sense. And then, but these things are quite, what do you got there? All those
things. The totem group and the interlocking forms.
Well, Carl, let's just stay, because Tom had asked, you do the charcoal, then you do it into a pencil line once you find your lines. And then at that point, do you start taping? Once you've put the pencil lines.
Yeah, after
you start,
it's all done, the design part. Then I would make a very thin turpentine wash. But maybe you'll get it. A thin. It only gets the ring four times, so it's all right. It's mostly somebody that's in your neighborhood and wants to fix your house. Yeah.
So thin turpentine wash.
Thin turpentine wash, and then give that a week to dry. And then put a color opaque paint on top of that, and you'd have sort of a light ultramarine blue, but you wouldn't know exactly how light, and just enough to give you a direction, but the final choice would be made by what color was down there already, but you're constantly building out. At no point are you just kind of automatically doing something, especially with those Viet Cong paintings. you really didn't see it until the three different stages.
And you said typically it was two layers of paint for each color. Is that a standard thing, or would there be sort of very subtle modifications from the first or second, and maybe upper layers?
Where's my?
You want the walker?
Yeah.
Okay.
The one on the left, on the left is the Viet Cong painting.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And then colors are just intuitively put down, washed in, and then go from there. And I guess all the space and everything happens when you have to get the paint on. This one over here, I kind of ran out of gas after about 25 paintings of different kinds. So then I started to make a new module. So I spent about 2 weeks drawing, trying to get another module with a circle in it. And I got it finally. And for those of you that can see it, I thought, I've got it. And my old painter friend Danny Farber came by and said, "That's the logo on the Angel Stadium." And he spent all his time doing something. But even between those similar, you got a whole different kind of a feel.
And Carl, when you say your painting were intuitive, the color choice was intuitive.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about that? I mean, how did you?
Well, you look at some. Here's one without any circles in it. Those are all 5x5. So you'd look, you'd have it out on your canvas, drawn out. So then you look at it.
Well, look, Beverly has something.
See, this is more important because it's until some color suggested itself for the field. And the field is obviously the. So then you wash that in, and then you're looking at it until another element suggests a color, and then you got to do something that goes with the first two. I mean, they bring forth something. So I mean, it's intuitive, but it's based on. So you're making a whole thing, an organic, complete thing. Which is what I think is creative, which is what the artist doesn't feel real organically sound. So you're putting it up here.
Are there any of these colors that you mix, do you ever think that's such a great color, I'm gonna make up a lot and keep it for something else?
I wanna show one more thing.
Okay.
That's my Three Mile Island series.
Mm.
This is the only boring series I ever did in my life. it's like an art school exercise.
Well, that looks a little.
But they look, when I was done, they look beautiful, but.
Just as a reproduction, it looks a little bit like New York's color field.
Yeah, yeah. You know, with this New York thing, one time, Clement Greenberg was out here. And I was invited into L.A. He gave a talk somewhere, and we had lunch after the talk. And then I was having a show. So the person from the art department here was driving him around L.A. for that time. And I guess one time about 10 o'clock at night, right after I had what I thought was my last drink, the phone rang, and this guy said, "Greenberg wants to come to your house." I said, "Okay." I said, "Sure, it's fine." So he came out, and in those days you could get from LA to here in 45 minutes. And he was really, I always liked his writing, but he was very, very impressed with what I was doing. I could feel that. And he said, you're a master painter. And, you know, coming from Greenberg, and especially living out of the line of fire, that's wonderful. But he said, you can't paint here. And I said, look, I'm 60 years old, and I've been doing all this stuff, and he just said I was a real good painter. I said, why, how can you say that? He said, well, it's too nice. There's the flowers and the nice house and neighborhood, and you got to be in New York and feel that gritty, bullshit, you know. But that's how he saw it. But he was willing to say, then he said, and you know, I'll give you one more tip. He said, paint with a trowel. And I said, I can't get that effect with a trowel. I used to want to try that. So he picked that out of me, I guess. But that was a funny experience.
Carl, about the surface of your paintings, do you play with different glosses, different textures, with sort of more brush strokes? It's supposed to be very even.
Yeah, ever since I stopped using the palette knife for the still up for some of the thick colors. So ever since 1960, it was that.
And you tend to use opaque colors as a rule, or try and mix up an opaque.
Do which?
Do you tend to use opaque pigments, opaque colors?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. And you've never varnished a painting?
Only if it was a real dark painting or a painting that sunk in real bad and I didn't get the right amount of oil in, then I would kind of have to do a middle varnish. What do you call it? Not gloss.
I would say a satin finish or a...
Yeah. Between shiny and dull, a medium.
And that would just be a regular artist's varnish?
Yeah. Okay. So I just use, there's a little stand oil in the paint, depending on the thickness of the paint, the consistency of the paint. And that's all.
And the stand oil was there just to ease the application or to affect
which was to distribute a real thick paint. Two things, to smooth it out, to control the brush marks. That's another thing Lorcer did. He'd be in a big field and he'd go whip with the same color and you got 18 different colors as the light hits them in different ways. So all of my paintings, the final brush mark is up and down. And so after I put the paint on with a little brush, then with a big brush, I take a bigger brush and this way, then up. So all the lights are hitting that. And you don't get any glares. So it stays one color.
And I think I know the answer to this. I mean, you just said that, but does the canvas stay the same orientation throughout the process, or do you turn sometimes and rotate?
No.
No.
Yeah. No. Well, okay, you would take 5 minutes
or
so.
Yeah, absolutely.
On masonite, and it was unframed and dirty. And I looked at it and thought, geez, how did I lose this? So we had it cleaned. And that would be 53. Mm. Still the palette knife, still with the palette knife with the light colors. But a whole different feeling. From that to, although I'm not negating that.
Was this in your first solo show, this painting?
No. It could have been, I mean, but it wasn't. But I really like that painting. That's just it's a good example of the.
Well, what do you think, if I look at this, some of the shapes end up kind of expanding and becoming a lot like the later paintings.
Yeah, sure. That was downtown in Chino, which is a little town south of here, where I taught, that's where I was teaching. And that was the shopping downtown, which had already gone to seed. Those were empty storefronts. But I mean, it sure does that compared to. And as I always think about Chicago, being brought up looking out of an apartment, and the wall up over there is full of windows,
mm-hmm.
and it's a dominant city.
Cityscape.
Formal thing.
And one of the first early important shows you were in was about painting and architecture, right? At LACMA?
The last one?
No, one of the very early.
Oh, yeah. There was a show at Barnesdale Park.
Yeah.
And it was called Arts in Architecture. And I remember I was paintings that probably trying to make a good excuse for abstract paintings. Probably what it was for that time was probably that. And I had a painting from that period. I don't have any, they were, instead of window shapes, instead of window shapes, it was football shapes. So.
We sit down?
Yeah.
You know, when the show was and whose work.
How it came into being, you know, that.
Well, the four artists were, of course, John McLaughlin and Fred Hammersley and me and.
Lorser,
yeah, sure. And, and it's still very clear in my mind how that got together because I was here, Fred was teaching it. At Pomona College, we were slightly acquainted, and Lorser was in Los Angeles, a well-known painter, and McLaughlin was just getting started. He was showing with Felix Landau, and I didn't particularly like his paintings. I mean, to me, it was like Mondrian. Totally wrong, but that's what they were to me. And Peter Sells was head of the department at Pomona. And we were good friends with them. And so at that time, the thing was, if you're out here, you're painting like the Miller Cheese crowd. Can he come in?
Okay.
He'll be very good.
Yeah.
He loves to come in. Just leave it open. Leave it open. Okay, come in and settle down. Mm-hmm. Come on. Lie down now. So at that time, it was either you either paint like that, or if you were an abstract painter, it had to be sort of related to New York School with very brushy stuff, and you couldn't if you didn't fit any of those categories, a realist or a Sheets type realist or a the other kind, there's no critics had no word for it. So I remember Peter came by here. We were, as I say, very close friends, and he or I said, "What are we going to do about your career? Because you're not identified with anything. There's no schools." And so he said, "Well, there are other people around that are painting with these abstract shapes." I mentioned those three who I knew slightly, whose work I knew. And Peter said, "Well, I'll have a show here at Pomona Gallery, which is very nice now." And he was interested in pushing Fred's work. He didn't like abstract painting. He liked German Expressionism, being all on Peter's cells.
Mm-hmm.
But we were all, he was being friendly with me. And so we figured out these four guys, the only people in sight that were painting with these shapes. And Jules Langster got interested because he was interested. He gave us, all four of us, gave us good reviews.
But first Peter said he would do it out here.
Peter was here at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah. And then he said, "Well, we'll have the show out here at the Pomona Galleries." And Jules thought that was fine, so we had some meetings at Lorcher's house or at my house and talking about things. And nobody was talking about having the same philosophy or anything. It's just that we had this similarity, and this would, we had a name. It would be a, something for critics to sink their teeth in. So there's all kind of suggestions about what to use for a name. And we're still arguing who to blame for that. I think it probably was either one of the two art historians. Because, I mean, I hated the word.
You were talking about the term abstract classicism.
Yeah, but then I remember I said, well, okay, because they're talking now about abstract expressionism, and there's always been this Dionysian and the Apollonian, and so you've got the wild painters and the, of course, I was thinking now these are as wild as I want to get, but that's just how you were forced into thinking. So that's what we got, abstract classicism. And of course, McLaughlin was totally philosophical and spiritual about his stuff. He had, and I'm sure Lorster had his own idea, and Fred never said much. Sneered.
Tell us the title again.
Abstract Classicists.
And when you were having conversations, it was less about approach and philosophy and more about finding a way to connect the work?
Was to get a name for it was sort of merchandising in a sense. I mean, it was something that people could, and it worked in a way.
Well, there, I've been thinking there's
what do you call this? Nobody said, what do you call this anymore?
It's an odd collection of four because Lorser and John McLaughlin were born in 1898.
Right.
You're born in 1925. They're 27 years older than you are.
Right. And Fred was about, he was only about 4 years older than me. Well, there weren't that many painters around, as a matter of fact, so that really, that didn't matter. I don't think that mattered that much. Most of us, are you an abstract expressionist? I mean, are you an action painter? Or are you an American scene painter?
So you that age difference wasn't a big deal to
you? I don't know.
Did you feel like it was a good group and that your works were connected in certain
ways? Yeah, it was connected in a way. We were all serious and... Yeah, it was connected in the sense that it didn't look like American landscape painting or figure painting. Didn't look like Rico LeBrun. That's it, you know. All the guys that went to school my age, he had all the hotshot guys went to Rico's school. He was the best teacher of the bunch. And they had their label, sort of, which was justified and helped them. So it gave the critics something to argue about.
How many works were in the show, and who helped select them?
Well, we all selected our own work. I remember the museum guy telling me, "Can you please put some more variety?" Because I had all the ones that were.
With the interlocking forms.
Sort of the interlocking forms. And to me, there was a first really consistent group of paintings I did. I was trying all this and that and the other thing.
So tell us how you got to the interlocking forms.
Making marks on the canvas and sideways and then up and down. I can look back now and say I used to like to look at Duchamp's paintings. I love to look at them. Well, that's probably where that formal set got clarified in my brain.
But also, were those breakthroughs also, color seems to become more and more important.
For me, yeah. McLaughlin used to kid me about it. You always see that very seductive color. you know, said, because he said you only use the color when you filled in the black part and the white part, and you need another element to make. So that's how that. And Fred was strictly the went his own way. And Fred and I, huh?
I was gonna. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No.
How was the show received? Was it well attended, and how was it written up?
Well, Jules was very good about it because he put in Art News, and he was the top critic on the West Coast at that point. And he knew people in New York and Paris. And so then I think he hooked us up with for the Englishman.
Lawrence Alloway.
Who?
Alloway,
Lawrence Alloway, yeah. Because that's how we went over there. And he then called the West Coast Hard Edge, which I thought was even worse, because I mean, what is a soft edge, you know? What did that say? There's one book on the table in there with a color plate on the top. The Europeans are much, much more involved in that kind of pure rectangle stuff. Mine never was about that. I think these guys, all four of us, except for John, were basically romantic painters. McLaughlin was about different, something different.
What kind of personality was John?
Oh, he was a neat guy. He was like a British lord or something. He was very Boston, very English. He spent a lot of time in religious studies in the Far East. He was only interested in philosophy. That's why he was the favorite of guys like Henry Seldes, who was the big critic out here at the time. Because we have a show, McLaughlin would always have a three-page statement about his paintings. So he'd give that to these critics that didn't know how to write about a non-objective painting. And there it was, you know. And I'm my old illiterate self, and Lorcer was so bombastic, and Fred was quiet, so McLaughlin gave him some words to use. So that's why really he got a lot more. The rest of us were two good galleries, but nobody that was as good as
as John.
Yeah.
Well, it's about four. Absolutely, it was an incredibly important show. It traveled around, and then, you know, when it went to London, David Hockney, other people said that it had a huge impact on it.
It was at the Institute of Contemporary Art, and went to some place in Ireland, Queen's College in Ireland, and I toured this country. Another version of that show toured this country for quite a while. There was the show came back from Europe. It was really funny because that was when I guess that's when Kennedy was president. Mm-hmm. And the show came back and after a long journey and Kennedy's being president was going to set a whole new thing. It was like we thought Obama was going to be here. And it was going to be good for the arts and all these things. And all of a sudden, we all got to notice that your paintings are in a ship out off the coast of Los Angeles, and you owe X number of dollars. None of us which had X number of dollars. I probably was making $3,600 a year teaching school. And we thought, this is fine. It's kind of like his speech the other night of Obama. Except they charged us to get our paintings out of the hook. That was really funny.
Did you go to London? Did you go to Europe?
Oh, no. I never could sum up the cash to...
Were you showing your paintings at a gallery at that point? Was there?
Yeah. I think I was with Esther Robles, which was a good gallery, but as I look back on it, she wanted one of those, meaning one of those funny hard edge painters. She was really was more of a semi-figurative painter, painterly paintings.
Was she selling? Was your work selling?
No. My work really never sold very well. Not much.
But after abstract classicists, you started to become pretty well known and were in a bunch of significant exhibitions, the Responsive Eye at the Museum of Modern Art.
Yeah.
How did that feel, getting that recognition? And because you were still a relatively young man. And
it's hard to answer that question, really. Looking back, I looked back on it, but I wasn't really conscious of that. I was pretty occupied. I mean, I really still was occupied teaching, although I would have quit if I could have. But I still, it wasn't a job. I mean, I really got, that's before I was at Pomona, which was a 15-year, 20-year vacation. But what was your original question?
What did it feel like to start really getting recognition?
I didn't feel that all that much because I was so preoccupied with other things. I mean, I started the teachers union. I mean, the American Federation of Teachers at the where I was teaching. It was only the California Teachers Association at that time, and so I was always in all kind of trouble over that kind of stuff as a lefty, and a. And then we had, Bevy and I were co-chairman of a referendum in Claremont for better zoning, and I was getting into political stuff all the time. And our kids got the high school age and very involving. And it just seemed so far away, and I finally got to a point where driving into LA at night, and then having to get up early in the morning to go over to Chino. I just got separate. I never let up on the painting. Mm-hmm. But the career part of it meant less. And I always felt ill at ease at big openings because everybody seemed to be in a certain social aura.
That's something that Catherine and I really wanted to ask you about is what you talked a little bit about John, but he lived in Dana Point.
Yeah. There,
how did you, what kind of artistic community were you able to create for yourself out here? Who were you close to?
Well, the faculties of the colleges here, some of them. But again, it was not. I mean, I knew a lot of painters. The Venice guys,
Ferris
guys. You know, I knew a lot of those guys, sort of. But there was such an inner, those were groups, social groups that they did their painting and then they did their social stuff. And I had family stuff and teaching stuff and citizen stuff, and I mean, I was not focusing on my career. And finally, I didn't care so much anymore. I never was worried about making money. I made enough to live on. And if you sold something, that was nice. And if you didn't,
but because I think people have the idea. You just talked about the Ferris group, and they'd paint all day together, and they'd go to Barney's Beanery and drink.
Barney's Beanery.
But you and John and Lorser and Fred did not have that kind of relationship, right?
No. Fred and I have been all close all the time. But, I mean, Lorser, Roger was always a guy pretty much by himself. I mean, he was pretty bombastic. I mean, we were friends, but he was a difficult guy to like. And this big show at Santa Barbara right now. Now, he got left out of that show. And have you seen the lineup in that show? I mean, everybody that was a good painter from the war on. And I asked Louis Stern, I said, why did they leave out Lorster? And they made some remark. Well, he alienated an awful lot of people. I mean, he was bombastic, and he was not very, never was bad to me or anything, but. And also, for an artist at that time, to be constantly making very nasty remarks about the homosexual museum directors and the queer critics and all this kind of stuff. I used to want to say, well, shut up with that, you know.
Would you visit Fred's studio?
Oh, yeah. Of course, he was here for quite a while. And then when he lived in Silver Lake. But Larson, we'd have something there once in a while. And Helen.
But Fred and you saw each other a lot.
Pardon me?
Fred Hammersley and you saw each other a lot.
Yeah. And telephoned. We phone every few months up until he died.
But for all those years you both were living at Claremont, did you go look at each other's work regularly?
Yeah. He thought I painted too much. He said, you ever seen his notebooks? He'd made many, many, many studies until he'd get one thing he wanted. And I just start rubbing on it with a soft charcoal on canvas. And he said, Carl, just don't paint so much. He was a funny guy. And Larcher, he was sometimes he painted like he was, which was, I know there was so little, there's really so little connection except a clean edge in all four of us that it's incredible that we got so much mileage as we did out of that, because it really meant nothing. It really didn't.
But I think you told us last time we were here, it was important to know that there were other people doing something. As you said, you were surrounded by realists and action painters. And even though there's nothing that similar between the four of you, it was important to know that other people were doing something different.
Yeah. I don't know, really.
Carl, would you drive into Los Angeles for certain shows?
Oh, lots of times I go in. I always take one of my kids with me, my own kids. Then they got to know the galleries.
What galleries would you go to? Would you go to the Monday Night Walks on La Cienega?
Sometimes.
What galleries were you?
Well, all the ones on La Cienega. From Barney's Beanery down to Melrose.
What did you think of the Ferris Gallery and the guys that were doing work there?
Oh, I like most of their work. I like painting. I had a feeling that I was. I remember meeting Fred a lot on those Monday night things in there, walking up and down the street. Those are fun. But there again, that's one of the things I began to think, why am I doing this? I'm so tired the next day, because I drive all the way back. This is no place to be a career artist, and especially now.
We're going? Okay, so you were going to lead us up to this.
Oh, okay.
So you wanted to start with some of the earlier interlocking.
Did you want to do that now?
We're ready.
For this?
Yeah.
Oh, I was just saying that these were all overall patterns for the most part. And those were the ones I think, an afterthought, I see the mark of Marcel Duchamp in those. because John Copeland once was looking at these. And he said he ran, when he saw them in London, they reminded him of urban crowds. And that I never saw the figures in them. And I, now I can see figurative shapes in them. But
so you actually, so you do see the sort of totem or figure.
I see it now. I didn't.
Okay, you didn't then.
No, but this one was different from all of the other ones. I must have done 50 or 60 of those. And I can remember so well out here. When did I paint that? What does it say?
That's 1959.
I didn't do it out here. I did it in the other studio. I just felt so, I was so pissed off at something that I smeared out all the chalk marks, and I just had left the outside parts, and I put the ugliest magenta-like color, and I said, I just was feeling hostile, and people hate this, but I really feel like this color. And Beverly didn't want it in the front room. She thought it was really ugly. And it holds up great. And Louis sold it, Louis Stern, after 40 years.
What did you think when Alloway singled it out as the one that he really liked?
That he really liked? Oh, well, that was very good to hear. I mean, those things make you feel good. But I just remember the hostility. I usually didn't. Some painters paint like that a lot, I think. But that's the only time I ever, I forget what I was mad at. But it was something. It was about the size of that one on it, sideways.
While we have you, you were just talking about the interlocking shapes, and then there are the form-space paintings, which look kind of like the. These that you go back to. Or these ones are really good examples.
Yeah, this.
But don't hold it in front of your face. Can you tell us about those? Because they have some of the same, but a very different feeling for them.
This series, there are a bunch of these. I've got those. There's several of them right in that rack there. I painted these, I realized after the summer that I spent the whole summer painting this house. And you can see the post and beam stuff. And anyhow, I did a whole series where instead of drawing, I used tape to draw. So the tape, can you see from? The tape was black. That was going to be black. So after I had all the tape just like I wanted it, I painted the colors on the outside of the tape. And then took the tape off, and when that dried, I did the black. That's what these were.
So you started by drawing just with the black tape?
Yeah, so that was my drawing. In a sense, with a drawing, with a tape. It was a structure. It was a structure of the painting. And after a while, you got to the end of the rope on that bunch. You ran out of gas. So they seemed awfully static. So I started another bunch that were related, and that includes that one. And luckily, that's in that show at the Santa Barbara Museum. And they called me up and said, can we make a banner out of your painting? I said, wonderful. They only made about that much of it. But it's a huge banner out in front of the, sent me a picture. But that was called floating grid. So instead of a nailed down sort of a grid, it was a floating grid. FS number 16. And that's where those titles.
And how'd you come with the FS?
Wow. Well, you could do it on the way to lunch. Stop by my old studio right there. And there was a period where I was all screwed up and I couldn't paint much. And I had a big box of wood scraps. So I started putting them together. It was right after I did these. And I got one out there in the studio right now that I just took out and had cleaned. A three-dimensional version of one of these.
So you were actually experimenting three.
So I put all these pieces of wood together without a plan. Until he finished. So I can show you that easily, very easily on the way out. One picture is worth 1,000 words.
I think, should we take a break now? Is this a good time? Would you like to take a, we'll go get something to eat and you take a little rest?
Yeah, that'd be swell.
Okay.
You know.
Here's one. Those have numbers on them?
Yeah, these ones have numbers too.
Okay.
Yeah, those are sequences.
Yeah.
There were some. These are. This is a quadrants.
It says module triangle.
I had.
As the paper shows the.
These shapes. Yeah. The various sequences.
Yeah. I was doing some of these with four quadrants. Each quadrant the same, but I tilted the whole. Okay. Mm. Then that got, again, needed air. So I cut the quadrants in half. And here, give me. Oh, here they are. See.
Yeah.
I mean, just did a lot of work with any actual, in the old sense of the word, designing and I think it was because you knew how to do all the other stuff. And wanted to see what other kind of things would give a meaningful unity. I just had this show at the graduate school. There's a catalog for those right in that pile there. I'd like to give you one of those when you leave.
Okay.
If you see a...
That was the first when they reopened the gallery, right? They had the show?
Yeah. Yes. Hooray. Morgan, great. Thank you. There are two galleries over in the graduate school,
mm-hmm.
and a big lobby in between. They gave me both galleries, and one gallery, David Pagel. I did these, it says 1881, that puts me ahead of Monet, right? These are 4 by 5 feet, and I painted them as a unit in 81. And I never could get them shown as one whole piece.
As one whole piece, yeah.
Because I also wanted to sell them as one, and nobody wanted to buy
four paintings. Yeah.
Eight.
Oh, eight, yeah.
So I sat on them until a couple of months ago. These got kind of dark. The reproductions aren't good. But this was on just one, had a whole gallery all by itself, just this one wall. And then the other wall. With the two different kinds. See, these are the half quadrants, and these are the numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Notice how some make circles. You can take one of these with you. And I would like to draw your attention when you look through this. My daughter, Beth, who's 60 next year, wrote a poem. And David Pagel said, can I use the poem in the catalog? And I said, sure. And it really tells something about me as a painter. Jeez.
Is it the beginning?
I remember the green movement.
The literary skills skipped a generation.
Well, she was writing poetry in kindergarten. She could read everything in the house before she went to.
Was it at the beginning?
The poem?
Yeah, was it at the beginning, right after? Because I think you passed it. that it?
No.
There.
Yep. Yep. This is, I think, really good. Just about me, but because there are a lot of guys like me. And we were all talking about my career and shows and how do you do the paintings and all this stuff. And this is an equally important part. So hope you all get a chance to read that.
Okay.
So Andrew, do you maybe want to tell Carl a little bit about what?
That shown in Birth of the Cool, though?
That was shown at the LA County Museum, Four Abstract Glasses, the show.
This one, Yellow Ochre Umber.
Yeah.
But it wasn't in Birth of the Cool, in the recent one.
Was it in Newport?
Newport.
Yes, it was. It was. That's in Claremont. I traded that painting for a hernia operation. Dr. Ken Bonilla.
That's good. But that was shown in Birth of the Cool.
Can I have that? I want to show that one. You liked that drawing before. It was Bud's Bike Shop. Here it is.
Yeah. We passed by it today.
Yeah.
There's two bike stores there.
Yeah, but is long gone. But that was, that building, half that building is gone.
And then we've been thinking of, this one's been shown a lot, they're one of the floating structures.
Well, I've got no, it was right in there.
Do you really?
Yeah.
We should pull. Yeah. Why don't we finish?
Floating structures? Wait a minute now. I don't have a lot of those. I think there are several. It would only take me a minute.
Well, you know what we'll do? Why don't we ask whatever remaining questions we have while we're seated, and then we can take a look at some things.
Yeah, because I want to move the furniture around so we can actually,
Okay.
Look at the paintings and stuff in a good way.
Is that glass open?
Nope.
Yeah, would you?
I mean, they use, because I know, you know, McLaughlin especially, when you see some of the damage, you know, some of the canvases now.
Well, that was partly due to Nick Wilder, who was a good guy, but he was a terrific dealer, but boy, he was hard on paintings.
How so?
Well, just the way he handled them. I mean, he just, and John was not a real good person to go after that kind of stuff. I mean, he didn't care that much. He made this image, and then he put it in a, wouldn't frame them. Well, you can't take an unframed, hard-edged painting through colors and send it out into the world, and not, you can't put it in your own racks unless you got a strip around it. You know, it just, so they were all beat up, and he was getting hard of eyesight toward the end, and he you could see things that he didn't, I'm sure he didn't know that they were there, but they were showing through, paint was coming through the other side. I saw that stuff.
What materials was he using?
He painted on mostly on material, some kind of cotton or linen. He wasn't really interested in the side of it.
He used house paint things too.
Pardon me?
He used house paint sometimes.
I think so, yeah.
And where was he working?
In his studio down there in Dana Point. He just was not interested like I was. And they got beat up.
We heard too that at one point at Nick Wilder's there was a flood.
Who was some painter that was in there that quit the gallery or threatened to quit the gallery until Nick got rid of this big bulldog. And he had his dog tied to, I think it was a big bull. And it was tied to the desk, as I remember. And on the carpet, this on La Cienega, when he had a gallery, big pee marks on all over the place. And whoever that painter was, either you get rid of that dog or I'm taking my paintings out of here. I mean, here the paintings stacked up and the dog lifting his leg. And I'm not exaggerating.
What kind of guy was Nick Wilder?
Pardon me?
What type of person was Nick Wilder? Everybody who we talked to seems to have such a...
Well, personally, yeah, I thought he was, but you know, he was the guy who discovered the big, huh?
Naumann.
I mean, he likes stuff like that. I was in that gallery, and just to show you, in Los Angeles, and I was talking with him, and he was a nice guy. When I had a show in New York, he came to the gallery, said, anything I can do for you, you know, let me know. There's no reason to do that. But anyhow, that day, I walk in there, and what the hell was I starting to say? Where did I peel away?
You were at Nick Wilder's gallery.
Yeah, I was.
Telling us kind of what, you know, what kind of character he was.
Oh, yeah. When I walked in the gallery,
yeah.
I see this old piece of, looked like it was gutters, pieces to, on a fascia, to take the rain out of. And was lying there on the floor. I thought he was having some work done. And I said, well, what are you doing? Are you fixing your roof? And he said, and he laughed at me, and he said, no, this is Bruce Nauman.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you'll hear from him. He had never had a show. I never even, that's when I was in there a lot. I never even heard the name. He said, but I don't understand what he does. And so, because I'm a painter. I mean, I quit trying to understand things that aren't about paint. That's just what I have to settle for. But anyhow, he was like that. So we wouldn't be worrying about splotches on your paint. That would be interesting. It might show some where you threw an apple at your boyfriend and hit the canvas or something.
Had you heard anything about the flood in his gallery?
No. Never heard about that one. Not surprised. No, he died pretty young too. He was.
Yeah. Did John work outside, or did, I mean, he lived by the beach and there was...
Inside, he was inside.
He worked inside?
Kind of a living room environment. And then he had some people gave him a house, I think, up there. That was the last place where I went to visit him. And it had kind of a big studio instead of a front room. It was half house, half studio. It was very nice.
One other thing I wanted to ask, is there like a preferable viewing distance for your painting?
Say again.
Is there for the viewer, is there a good spot, like is there a preferable viewing distance for certain paintings that you want somebody to see, and how long should they look at the painting?
Well, geez, you know, I've looked at some of these paintings a long time. In the last few years, I have really seen stuff in my paintings I never saw before. It's just amazing at this stage of the game. But you know, it's like whatever you're painting on, when you're painting, you're totally involved in that. And your new work that you're doing. And so when somebody refers to a previous painting, you say, "Well, that's good, but you're not excited. You're not in love with that anymore." But the thing on the easel is a real love affair at this point. So you don't. As soon as you're done, they go in a rack, or a gallery or something, and in a way, they're out of intimate contact, emotional contact. But when you're not painting, they all come out. That those quarter inch Peter wanted me to take that off. That was hanging on that wall there. And I put it there because it was set off those two and to fill that space. Those are hard paintings to get with, but those people that dig them, really dig them. I mean, Louis Sturm, I don't really, don't repeat me, but I really don't think he's crazy about totally abstract art. I mean, he's a great dealer. He sold more of my stuff than in the last 15 years, in 2 years. But he likes those. Those quarter and stripe ones. When he goes to an art fair, if he's got a choice, he takes those along with him.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it's amazing, huh?
Which is in contrast to, I think I read somewhere where you had some of the early stripe paintings, and you said my LA gallerist didn't want to hang them.
Yeah, she was being polite, Esther Robles. She said, I don't think Los Angeles is ready for these. And I never, they're,
here.
59. I'm not one to talk about first, but I don't know anybody else painting with stripes before 1960. And I just did them out of a mistaken stimulus of Barnett Newman. Remember those order paintings, his big paintings with sort of a couple of
zips,
yeah.
Yeah.
And I thought, geez, you can make a painting with just horizontal stripes. And of course, those became color paintings. He wasn't interested in that part of it. But I really, outside of Barnett Newman with the zipper, I don't know anybody else. Gene Davis at Washington, D.C., he was an early, but I think.
These are very different than.
Not till the 60s. Yeah, they were. I saw a big show of his at the Corcoran. Yeah, those I'm really kind of. I probably sold one of those for $150, and Louis sold one for like the same size that for about $30,000. So that's how can you worry about money in this same paintings?
There's always a color rhythm.
Color rhythm?
Yeah. How do you establish that? Is it intuitive, or do you?
Again, if it's one of these, or if it's a Viet Cong painting, or a stripe painting, you just look, you have the drawing out there, and you look at it, and you have a canvas, and you got it drawn out, and now you're going to look for color. And one of them eventually will say orange, and you make that orange, and then I can't remember the sequence anymore. But another suggests itself. You just keep looking at what's there. You're just building on that, making that organic whole. I don't know, it's a funny.
Is it like music?
I'm sure it is. I mean, I'm sure there's a similarity.
Did you ever see any of the films of some of the abstract, non-objective filmmakers?
Yeah, what painting and the actor? Oh, yeah.
Like who? Do you remember any of them?
Well, just not offhand, I can't think.
But I think what Ryan's meaning is people like Oscar Fischinger or the Whitney Brothers, those completely abstract
films
with the color blocks that move.
Well, yeah, I don't know.
Were you interested in music?
Yeah, my grandfather was a cellist in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, and he was the one that kind of brought me up until I went to first or second grade, because he was home in the daytime. And my father was a medical intern that time, and my mother was teaching school. I sort of lived with my grandparents across the hall. So he took care of me in the daytime because his job was at night playing. And he taught me how to play piano. And I actually gave a few concerts, which I very vaguely remember when I was about seven. And then he died when I was about 8 or 9. And they said I never would play the piano anymore. But that was my first thing. Was.
And were you into jazz at all? Would you go to
Yeah, down? Jazz and classical. We were watching that thing on HBO last night, a rock and roll, the big, all the good guys. And I thought, geez, I missed that in a sense. Because I was really after, I was either jazz or classical music. And I just, I did not like it, but I just didn't bother to buy records of or play the, it was fun to hear.
Would you go to the Lighthouse or Billy Burke's? Or
yeah, Billy Burke's, I remember Billy Burke's and somebody.
Place on Central Avenue? Or?
No, not down there, in West L.A. Oh, you know the place. It's like Billy Burton. It's like Manhole, Shelley's Manhole.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And did you like the?
Yeah, I liked them. Yeah, but I never really. The Manhole played good stuff. Yeah.
What did you think of the, that, idea of Birth of the Cool that says that, your kind of painting. And sort of West Coast cool jazz have something to do with each other. Do you think that's true, or
had something to do with what?
With each other. That.
Well, all I know is that I wore out Miles Davis records. I mean, that's I just. And when I got out of the Navy, we'd come back from overseas and we were stationed in New York, and the war had just ended, and we were a flight crew, so we had nothing to do. So we got off 3 days out of four, and I lived. 3 nights out of 4 at 52nd Street, which was the place then. I mean, Dizzy Gillespie, Coleman Hawkins, that, I never forget that year I was this Billie Holiday. So I really, really loved that stuff, which was cool.
Yeah.
Would you ever listen to music when you were painting?
Yeah. Yeah, I had a record player when I was out in front.
For you, a lot of painting must have been a very painstaking, time-consuming process because you're truing the lines and taping and very physically tired, but also very labor-intensive. Is that right?
What was it?
Yeah.
I know. I had powerful leg muscles with those 6-foot-tall, 8-quarter-inch stripe paintings because that was about 150. Deep bends an hour going up and down the tape, and then going up and down to get it down, and then going then painting it, and then taking it off. I mean, man, I'm not kidding. That's when I, at one point there, were starting with those systems. I got a TV out here, and I started watching anything. If I got bored making tape, so it kept me at it. So anyhow, you do want early stuff for the show.
It's an early show, but even though I wish our show went later because the early 90s paintings, I think, are some of the best ones. Some of the ones you did in the early 90s, I think, are some.
Oh,
of the
yeah, best. Yeah, yeah.
Those are fantastic. That's 20 years after our show
ended. Yeah.
Because our show was ending in 1970.
Did you say before floating structures or the tape grid paintings?
Well, the floating structures one we're thinking, but I'd like to see the tape grid too.
Well, that was. Tape grid.
Yeah, and that's floating structure below it.
Now these. You talked about tickets in the bottle. This was the first bunch I did that were random systems. Well, that's the first. And these were big paintings.
And what was the system? Why don't you describe that a little bit?
Here's one. This was a big one. I numbered tickets, 1 to 24, and then I chose 24 paints.
Colors, yeah.
Yeah. To go with each one. And then I put the tickets in the jar, and my middle daughter was home then, and she pulled the tickets. And if it was number six, I'd put six up there, and then number two, and then until I got to the bottom. Then I put them back in the bottle again and start over and another. So that's what this was.
So completely random all the way down.
Yeah. But then, of course, after the first one, I realized I had to do one thing different. If two came bumper to bumper, then I put one back. Because it made a whole thing different.
Because it starts breaking the...
Then all of a sudden you got a double rectangle there, and it just screwed up the whole works. So that was the only thing. Well, then again, after a bunch of these, I was starting to go crazy. So I said, well, 1 to 12 would be field color. So that it's some air. So obviously that's magenta was my hostile color, my hate color. I think that's the only one of those, huh?
I'm just going to ask you whether this is something, because like the interlocking forms, you seem to alternate between filling the whole surface with a unit, you know, sort of one form, and then opening it up.
I think literally it's you get scrunched, and because you're identifying, you're in there. I mean, that's what your soul state is at that particular point. You remember Picasso was famous for saying about colors, and he said you paint, feel like green, and you paint green until you just don't feel like green anymore. So you paint something quite different. It's that kind of reaction. You had enough of something.
But you would literally feel constrained after these ones that go edge to edge and feel you needed to open.
Yeah. I open was the word that actually came to my mind. Whew, you know, I'm out of the underbrush. And not when I was doing them, until the last one or two maybe. Those were nice paintings. Those were a whole bunch of those and those. Oh.
So I have two last questions, and I think the first is, we weren't clear about, did you say that you mostly used paint right out of the tube, or did you do a lot of mixing?
No mixing, both. I mean, I mean there's a lot of really close value. These, of course, are no mixing. That would have to be mixing. Mm-hmm. For that. Those were interesting paintings. Those were, County Museum owns that one, I think. There's that same green again, went dead.
That went dead?
Yeah, that's a weird color.
Roughly how many paintings have that green on it where you notice this effect? Was it a couple or a dozen or?
Quite a few. Yeah. Hickey in that book there, he wrote, Louis Stern had him write an essay in there. And one of the things he liked about my work was that I think he said that he can paint green without having it look like grass. And so maybe there's something mystical about when I use that green, the cameras don't like it or something. But it's true. I mean, this one, and this was a whole series of manipulating a square and a circle. And sometimes it came out very simple, and sometimes it came out with symbols, and there's one in the front room right now.
Yeah.
And this is a really neat one.
Carl, did you ever read any color theory?
I read some by one guy from a long, when I was a beginner, but it never made any sense. I mean, I think I literally think that everybody, and this is from working with kids and other artists and me, that's a very unique thing in each person what colors are which. I mean, it's such a personal thing, not only the colors but the relationships and what that means. It's really loaded. It's just nonverbal, it's all. So it's hard to talk about specifically.
Do you consider yourself a spiritual person?
What?
Do you consider yourself a spiritual person?
I don't know.
Is your work spiritual?
Well, sure. I mean, art is a spiritual thing, ultimately. With that weird, what's happening between you and that bunch of colors or forms or whatever it is you're working on. It's more than what it is.
The colors and these, there's quite a bit of mixing, right, in these interlocking forms.
Those are pretty good colors. Those are funny. That feels funny. It looks nice, but.
You're asking if there's mixing?
Yeah, whether you were using it.
Oh, these are almost all mixing except the black.
Okay.
Everything, yeah.
Can I just ask one more question, Carl? The pink you mentioned and the green.
Pencil pink.
Where those colors were used, do you consider the paintings their special finish and their...
Do you know what? A miracle. I have looks like a a caramel. You want to get it? It's right there. You can have it.
I'll take it one second, yes.
Do you want some water, too?
Yeah. More.
Would help a little bit. Thanks.
So, as you're having your water, think about this as the last one. How different people have talked about you and what you think about it. That Langsner famously called you a classicist. Dave Hickey calls you a hedonist.
No, he said? I forget that.
David Pagel called you a pop painter. I mean, how do you, it seemed more to say about them than it does about you.
Oh, you're right. But that's true. Yeah. Anything anybody writes says more about them. Just like anything somebody paints says more about them. You know, you want to see, as close as I get to pop is next to the bathroom. When you go down the hall, to the left there's a small painting on the wall. It looks like Marilyn Monroe and Groucho Marx. I mean, I was thinking about Northwest Indian totems and what comes out, you know.
But it also doesn't seem like hedonist or classicist is quite right either.
Well, in a sense that there's no rules. I'm putting out, there's no rule for my putting anything on any. Making any line or any color or any shape or it's all willful. That's according to yourself, it has to go. But I mean, it's
sounds like you're an anarchist.
Yeah, sure you are. That's why I think people tend to have a lot of trouble with art.
Well, one of the problems, I think, of the term classicist for all of you guys is it gave people the wrong impression that the structure was already there and then you were just kind of filling it in with color.
I know. That was one of the things that was misleading, very, very misleading. But I was thinking more about, after you guys left, you were asking questions about our careers and stuff. And there is so much of that, at least in this country, with all of our peculiarities, financially, socially, it devolved into kind of a, whether it's Wall Street or Venice. I mean, abstract classes, we only were happy with that word because it gave us a name, made it a product, brand. And on the other hand, the guys from the Ferris Gallery, with a few collectors and a few museum people, were creating a myth for the same kind of reasons, that there was nothing in Los Angeles until the Ferris Gallery opened up, except for John McLaughlin, that had to have one entity back there. And those two guys were pretty good painters. Some of them were very good painters, but they didn't have to be, they had to be made into something holy, and they made a lot of money that way. The dealers and the whole thing that rose up around them, a mystique.
Christopher Knight was saying, because it's absolutely true that all those Ferris guys always said, all the hard edge guys, they didn't have a big influence on us because they wanted to be the first.
Oh.
But yeah. Christopher Knight said to me that he thinks that the whole light and space movement really comes out of the whole light and space movement, like Terrell, and
yeah,
comes out of your paintings,
huh,
and John's, and this feeling of color that floats.
Okay.
You know, this high key color that is kind of independent or has an independent quality.
That's interesting, but Christopher. I mean, I've never been a fan of his writing, as opposed to David. I mean, I love to write. David likes it or he doesn't like it, and he kind of wings it. And Christopher and I was always sort of academic to me, but he gave me a super review when I had that show at the Claremont Museum. I take every back bad that I ever said about.
Can I just ask one last question? Carl, we told you at the beginning that the idea for our exhibition is to have the work of the hard edge guys next to the ceramic sculptures. So, you know, a painting of yours could be next to a John Mason spear form or a Peter Volkis piece. What do you think about that idea?
Well, I think they both are out of the same society. They're coming out of the same currents of life. I can't, as long as you don't start to pin that down too much, it doesn't have to be. Do you happen to know the work of Harry McIntosh?
Yeah.
Harrison McIntosh. He's a Claremonter. I've got about 15 or 20 of his pots here. I mean, those things are, I feel just so much at home with those things. There was a show at Mount San Antonio Community College right here about 4 years ago, a three-person show in a very nice gallery. My paintings, Harry's pots, and furniture guy,
Kamaloof,
the three of us. I have a film of it. And I remember the night we were there, and those three guys in there, they just really had the smoothest gallery, and yet you wouldn't consider. Maloof was very conservative in his art outlook, and Harry is another kind of classicism. But they sure went together. I mean, it was.
Well, you know, they've had one of your paintings with a Maloof at the Huntington.
I saw the picture of that, yeah.
And for Pacific Standard Time, the Huntington's going to do a show on Sam Maloof and Claremont with all the
mm-hmm.
ceramics, peep glass, some painting. So that'll be interesting to see.
Depends on who gets a hold of that. My coffee table in there is Sam made about 50 years ago. And his favorite artist was Miller Cheats. He couldn't see why I didn't see how good Miller was. But Miller in those days could do anything for your career, and he really got Sam off to a great start. So.
But he immediately didn't like your work, so he was never trying to get you for home savings or any of that sort of that.
No.
Was it also part, we talked about making careers, and was it partially your politics that made you not want to, you know, sort of sell and?
I wasn't really political, very political then. I mean, I always voted for Norman Thomas or somebody, but I never was that much involved then, was later. When you said floating structure or tape grid, you meant the tape grid ones or the floating structure ones?
Well, I like them both. I'd like to hear you say more about what the difference is between the.
I'm trying to think. I've got the ones that are not like the wood piece, not the floating structure. I only got, although Louis, you could borrow one back,
mm-hmm.
From Louis or from Santa Barbara Museum. They've got, besides that one, they've got four of my very early paintings, three or four. When my wife and I and our three little kids, early in our marriage, we would have illnesses, we'd go up to Santa Barbara, where my father was a pathologist, and he was head pathologist at the Cottage Hospital. So one of his friends would do us an operation or fix us up. And then I'd give them a painting. He wouldn't take any money, so I'd give them a painting, which they would say thank you politely and quick get rid of it to the Santa Barbara Museum. So they got four.
Some really good ones?
Yeah, they got three later ones. I think they own this one. He was my father's intern and then later on the pathologist. Mm-hmm.
Is it up in the show currently?
No, I don't think so. That
this one is.
Oh, okay.
That yellow one.
Oh.
That
one.
Okay.
But I think I have a couple of these from that time. That are good here. And Louis knows where those things are. He could always get them back.
Yeah, and he's been very helpful.
Yeah.
He's real good about things.
Carl, was there anything that you were thinking that you wanted to talk about or something that when you knew we were coming, was there something that you wanted to remind yourself to tell us?
Well, not that I can think of at this point.
Should we,
maybe
we can look at
it? Well, that was from the 1960s. I just had it around, I don't know.
Can I ask, there's some black, there's a few swatches of black that are okay.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Is that, you see here, these ones, is it just a different color? It's a gray, not a black, or a different?
Point to it again.
This area, this one.
That's not black.
That's
gray. That's got white in it. So as soon as you got white in it, it's not a transparent thing like ivory black. Mm. Boy, that is. And I think if you paint it over that with black, sooner or later that pattern would come through. That was a neat painting. Until that happened, I mean, but it depended so much on this black on black. That's why they call them BBs.
Yeah.
I just was trying too hard to get real black.
And did this happen on more than one painting?
Yeah.
Okay, so you did this on a few.
Yeah, I did it until I caught on.
Right. Which one is a great painting?
It was like a Franz Klein in a way.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking about.
Carl, where do you think that the tape grid ones are? Are they here or in the other?
Well, I'll tell you what. Give me my dolly.
Oh yeah, here we go.
Oh yeah, there's one. Now, how's the black in there?
You can see it's kind of
Oh yeah, now that's come apart some.
Slowly back a little bit, yeah.
That's sort of a black and tape grid one.
Yeah.
Boy, that was. I had a hard few years in the 60s. I really did. I mean, it's not a cliche. Dark, you paint dark colors when you're in a dark mood. God, that's dark.
That is dark. I see that it was.
But when the black was really black, it looked good.
I see that it was $600 at one point, too. It says it on the back of the frame.
What did it say?
$600.
Yeah, that was a lot then. Okay. There we go. Some are kickoffs from that. But those are all from. Yeah. Take a look. You have to watch out for these fixtures.
Oh, yeah. That's your pink, right?
Is this the pink?
That well might be. That very well might be it.
See, Ronnie and Catherine and I want the ones that are perfect, and Tom wants all the ones that something's going wrong with.
So this clearly hasn't got the top coat with the very careful vertical brush strokes. That's just been left.
Those? Yeah, that's one of those. My favorite ones of this series had a field color and then two rectangles. They're I think are the best.
Do you have any of the symmetries or the interlocking forms here?
You know,
or those all with Louis and. We're just trying to find some. Actually, we'd be interested in general in sort of looking at some 50s or 60s.
Okay. There's a dark blue folder in that pile someplace. It says Louis Stern on the cover. No, on the table. No, on the little table.
Oh, sorry.
This might be a great boon. Nuts.
Right here.
There. Right, this is what I got from Louis.
Here, we can take this out.
These are.
This is an inventory he made of your?
No, yeah.
That's sold works.
These are sold.
This is a nice 64.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's one of those circles. And no, that isn't either. Yeah. Yeah, these are sold. Where's that unsold one?
Well, it doesn't matter if they're sold or not, because we can always...
Oh, that's right.
We can always...
Here's a plot that held up really well.
No, that's fine. So here, he's got these pictures here. And how big they are.
You want me to help?
We might need a
better. Okay, let me just lift this up here. And then it's got to go completely straight up. Or
you want me to hold that?
Yeah, but you can put it back.
Yeah, well, let's show Andrew.
I'll loan you that if you...
We can get that from, we can get it from Louis too.
Sure.
Okay, hold on.
These are, I love these ones.
Those are somewhat related to the ones that were in the show.
And this is pretty. Andrew, take a look. So these are the works that have sold.
Yeah.
We were just looking at this.
So we need to look for.
I want you to see one of those. Here's one. Here's
yeah.
Here's a pretty good one. I think the black is okay. That one is okay.
Yeah.
It wasn't black on black, it was just black.
Right.
So I didn't have to screw it up. Yeah.
This could be nice. That's an interesting one.
So on these areas, did you do more layers?
Yeah, a piece of tape and then a piece of tape on top of that. This is all a tape grid.
It's amazing because it still looks when a certain angle, like it has tape.
Yeah.
You see that.
If this had a coat of varnish on it, maybe.
What's really interesting is that physically the blue is on top of the black.
Right. Yeah.
But if you guys stand over here, the black looks on top of the blue.
Oh, wow, you're right. Yeah, there's a weird dimensionality to those edges.
Should we set it up the right way?
Yeah, why don't we put.
That's,
I got it.
Come this way, okay.
See, that's sunken in up there, sort of.
Yeah.
But I think that could get, if that was varnished. Hi. That one really looks good to me.
Yeah, it's a knockout.
My existential painting.
And there's another one that it was next to.
So is there an optimal viewing distance to see your work from?
Well, it depends on the work. You know, those quarter-inch stripes. Here's another one. Horizontal. I would guess that that's upside down, but maybe not.
Well, the writing, see, the writing.
Okay, you're right, that's right.
TG24, so you made quite a few of these.
Oh, a lot, yeah.
Which did you feel that the tape grids, did you feel that one series was more successful than the other, or did you like them equally well?
Well, I think they're all pretty much equally successful in what they were, except for the technical thing with the blacks. Mm. I mean, I was unhappy with those, put it that way. That echoed my mood.
Mm.
Oh, those are nighttime paintings.
Were you painting mostly at night when you said?
Yeah, because I was teaching in the daytime. That's why I got to read that poem in the catalog.
I like both these two are very interesting. This one, the color palette, and this one's kind of bright and more subdued.
Oh yeah, right. It's a sold, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a little one.
Yeah, this one's small.
I painted two of those, similar, one, two. My daughters were two in beds, and they each had one over there.
What's going on there?
I think it's just dust that hasn't just been cleaned up.
That's a. I'd buy that one. Both of those, really. I think both of those are.
Yeah.
Let me just get back there and see if.
Sure. Has Louis done an inventory of what you have here at the?
No. He's got about. What was this? Oh, here's one. This is a horizontal one.
That's an interesting one.
Ooh, yeah.
Things must have been going better. I really like that one.
Is that also a tape?
Yeah. And no, but it was painted about the same time.
C number one.
What is that?
It's a C number one.
Curve.
Curve.
They had a curve.
That's worth taking a picture.
But at the same time, 60s. Yeah, I would.
Is the shadow in the way of the picture? Should we do a shape?
I should do that one. I'm creating a shadow.
See, now these are the ones that very thin coats of paint, but they sure lasted.
But you can tell, I mean, Tom, did you take a look at this? Because this looks similar to the black.
Is there cracks in the black?
Yeah. Oh. Well, it looks similar to the black.
Oh, yeah.
It's cracking slightly.
Can I have your camera?
Of course.
The title and bow back here.
You want me to hold it?
Well, let's see here too.
Can you see that looks like dust?
I think
that's just dust.
There's a lot of dust.
That's dust.
Oh, dust.
That's
yeah.
dust, but the brown is similar to the black.
Well, that's umber. And I think umber's kind of fugitive in terms of strength. Boy, that is dust, isn't it?
Yeah.
Clean up my sleeve.
There's a medium-sized one in there that's you ought to take a look at if you're doing these.
Do you want some help?
I think
I got it. This one. It
goes
in.
Yeah, I'll move that one in.
No, more, right there, that one. Mm-hmm. Let's see if this is, I'm afraid this is a black on black one.
It says BB number 5, 1962.
Yeah, look at that. It's all crazed.
Yeah.
I really felt like Franz Klein when I was doing these. You know, they're sort of like that. Hard to imagine a hard edge Franz Klein.
Did you go to New York at times just to see work at all, or?
Three times I went for a couple of days or a week.
Do people ever come, like people who collected your work early on? Or museums, do they ever come back to you and ask you questions about the surface or ask you to redo something?
No, I never had to come back. Nobody's come back on that.
Are there other things we should see here? Are there some things,
Of these?
No, I mean, of the 50s or 60s, more here, or should we go for a few minutes to the other room?
Well, we could go in the other room. This big bunch here, those are all 90s.
Yeah, those are beautiful.
Oh, yeah, it was.
Well, we need the audio.
This is an audio thing.
Yeah.
It's small.
Should we put
one of those big Kong things look like? This is a small one.
I will.
Actually, they shouldn't be this small because it takes a bigger.
to really get the variation.
Well, it just takes more. More is better in these.
Mm-hmm.
But I just did one medium size.
What year
Is that one standing up there from? Looks like quite a very old one.
Yeah, that's when I used to use the palette knife. 50, that's, I think I was signing them and dating them. That's signed someplace. I would say it would be 54.
So this is mostly painted without the brush?
Yeah, the palette, that's the palette knife one.
And then you went back, for the interlocking forms, you went back to the brush?
Yeah, from then on I was all brush.
Did you favor small or?
Small one to put the paint on, and a wider one to smooth it out.
For the finishing, for the
left
final.
Bottom, right, up.
Left, bottom, right, up, okay. That's a very nice...
Yeah, that's one of the triangle systems. Right in the back there, there's two of those ones you were asking about. It might be fun to look at it just so you see what they look like.
Okay.
The first random ones.
Can somebody grab the middle? Just make sure it stays away from the paint. All right.
You guys are real good with paintings. Now that goes sideways.
Yeah.
You see the you can see the.
Yeah, I can.
And that changes the color.
Right.
So we're gonna swing it out. My way.
See how it settles down right away.
Yeah.
Feels pretty.
They really had to be that big. And something that's totally random to be able for that to have enough wood to work with. I did a couple that were 40 by 40, and I sold them. But people only bought about one because there was a bright red background. And I mean, I felt like there wasn't enough material in there to.
So here you really get that set. I mean, it's, has that sort of computer feel.
Do you always frame your paintings, Carl? Are they sometimes shown?
On the back. I said on the triangle.
Yeah.
On the back.
Do you make these strip frames yourself?
Yeah.
And do your paintings ever get shown without
frames? Without the frame on, and then I put the frame on.
Oh, okay.
With those I had stripped set back and the metallic one to set forward. That was kind of nice.
So you take the strip off for showing in the gallery?
No.
No. You would leave this on?
Yeah. Okay. Oh, sure. Yeah, I think that was good. And anyhow.
Well, this is an early one.
Yeah. Here's my daughter Beth. All
right. That's with the palette knife.
No, that's with the brush, believe it or not.
Oh, really?
That was, what was that saying there? 55? Yeah. So she was 5. Mm-hmm. That isn't Picasso. Boy, I just had that framed.
Is that your daughter?
Yeah, the oldest one. I was 55, so she was 5 years old then.
See, this is the what they artists